Open your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 11. I always want to make sure that I'm thankful in the Thanksgiving season, so I never listen to Christmas carols until the day after Thanksgiving, but I had them all stacked up and ready to go in our vehicles so that anytime I'm in there, I can hear Christmas songs, and I love them in church. Some people say, boy, I just get tired of them. Never. I usually stop listening to them around Valentine's Day because I want it to be special again the next year. Hebrews chapter 11, as you know, we've been in this chapter for several weeks. It's a recounting of men and women who are examples to us of faith. As I've mentioned many times, we want to be sure that we don't get the idea that these were extraordinary people. They were ordinary people who believed an extraordinary God. And faith is simply believing what God has said and then acting on that belief. And so if you're able to stand, I invite you to stand with me and I'll read what we've read for several weeks now as we work our way through the end of this chapter, beginning in verse 32. The scripture says, "And what shall I more say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon, and of Barak, and of Samson, and of Jephthah, and David also, and Samuel, and of the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, were out of weakness, were made strong, waxed valiant in the fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens." And tonight we'll begin in verse number 35, where it says, "Women received their dead raised to life again. Others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. And others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, were tempted, were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and in mountains, in dens and caves of the earth. And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise, God having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made perfect." Father, I thank you for these men and women that have challenged and encouraged my heart. And I pray, dear Lord, as we look at this passage of Scripture tonight, that once again we might be reminded that without faith, it's impossible to please God. And so, Lord, we thank you for the gift of faith. We thank you that it's by grace through faith that we were saved. And now, Lord, we thank you for the faith that allows us to just continue doing what you've called us to do and expect us to do. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Be seated, please. Verse 35 talks about by faith, women receive their dead raised to life again. When I think of that, I think back in 2 Kings chapter 4 to the Shunammite women. If you remember, Elisha, as he went about Israel, he had a school of prophets where he trained young preacher boys. And he was the man of God for the time in Israel. And so he was responsible to be the spiritual leader in Israel. Well, as he made his way through the countryside, he often stayed in the home of this family who evidently were very, very given to hospitality. In fact, he stayed so often that they decided to build a room on the side of their house so that the prophet might stay there. This is the biblical origins of the prophet chamber. A lot of churches have a place where missionaries or visiting preachers can stay. When we traveled in evangelism, We stayed oftentimes in churches that had prophets' chambers. And so they had a special place for Elisha. And Elisha said, "You've been such a blessing to me. I'd like to do something for you. What could we do to repay you?" And they said, "Well, we didn't do this to get paid back. We're not doing this to receive anything." And because of that kind of spirit, Elisha said, "The Lord has told me you're going to have a son." And the woman was a little bit hesitant. She said, "Come on." She goes, "We're pretty old to be having children." And Elisha said, "No, it's no doubt you're going to have a son." And not long after, she had a son. The joy of their old age. And as that child grew, they always understood that he was a gift from God. Well, in 2 Kings chapter 4, Dad is out working in the field, and the little guy is out there. I say little, he's probably 4, 5, 6 years old at the time. He's out there, and all of a sudden, he says, my head, and he collapses. And the dad, who is pretty much like most dads, knew exactly what to do. He said, "Take him to his mother." And so the servants carried the little guy into his mother, but mama couldn't make him well, and in fact, he died. Here's the promise from God, and now he's dead. And so she immediately puts on her cloak and gets ready for a journey, and she travels to the house of Elisha. Well, Elisha sees her coming afar off and sends his servant Gehazi and said, I think that's the Shunammite woman. Go find out. See if everything's okay." And so Gehazi comes up and runs to her, and he goes, he says, "Is everything well?" He says, "Is it well with you? Is it well with your husband? Is it well with your son?" And it's amazing, her response. Amazing. I can't even imagine what it would be like to lose a child. Losing a loved one is never easy. In fact, it's probably the greatest struggle in life. But to lose a child. And Gehazi asked her, said, "Is it well with you and with your husband and with the child?" And she said, "It is well. It is well." Her child lay on the bed back at home, no breath, he's dead. How can she say it's well? This blessing from God that was unexpected, but now for 4 to 6 years, she's had the opportunity to raise this child every day, knowing he's a gift from God. And now, suddenly, tragically, he's gone. And when the prophet says, "Is everything well?" she says, "It's well." How in the world could she say such a thing? Only one way. By faith. By faith. You say, "Well, do you think maybe she knew that God would allow him to be raised from the dead?" I don't know. I think that she hoped that was the possibility. Otherwise, she wouldn't have come to the man of God. But I'm not convinced that she had reached the place where she'd resigned herself to the fact everything's going to be okay. He's going to be alive this time tomorrow. I don't think that she had that confidence. I think that she was at the place where she recognized God gave us a wonderful gift, and if it's the Lord's will to take him, it's well. If God gives him back to us, oh, it'll be marvelous. But if God decides it's best for him to spend the rest of eternity in heaven, It's well. It's well. Well, you know the story. Elisha went home, stretched himself out on that little guy. He rose again. He rose again because of the power of God. Elisha didn't have the ability to raise people from the dead. Only God can do that. And yet, she was rewarded with a child for her kindness to the man of God. And now the Lord has seen fit to raise one who was dead back to life by faith, the Bible says. I think the point of including this in the scripture is to recognize that faith is not always easy. I can't imagine it would have been easy for this one to say, yeah, it's well. My child's dead, but that's okay. When I read that, I'm reminded of the story of Horatio Spafford in the 1800s. He was a preacher. He was invited to preach in England. They didn't have airplanes, obviously, and so he set sail on board ship to go to England to preach. And the meeting became extended. In those days, they didn't have Sunday to Wednesday or Sunday to Friday. They just started the meeting and preached till God quit working. Sometimes the meetings would last 2 weeks or 3 weeks or 4 weeks or 6 weeks. You read the biography of Charles Finney, he often had two-month revivals. Amazing. Amazing. But he's there, and it's obvious the meeting's going to be extended, and so he sends for his wife and his two daughters. And as they're sailing across the Atlantic, the ship encounters a terrible storm, and his two daughters died. The ship went down, and he lost his daughters. His heart is broken. He got on board ship to go back home to be reunited with his wife. He asked the captain, he said, when we get to the place closest to where you think that ship went down, I'd like to know. And so after a few days, the captain knocked on his door and said, this is pretty close to where the ship went down. Mr. Spafford went back into his room and he began to sob, and cry out with great tears. And he wrestled with God. By his own biography, he said, I asked God why. And he said, I finally reached a place where I recognized that God doesn't make mistakes. And even though this isn't what I wanted, it's what God wanted. And if this is what God wants, then it must be well. And so he took out some paper and he wrote these words. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. By faith, women receive their dead raised to life again. It goes on to tell us in verse 35, and others were tortured, not accepting deliverance that they might obtain a better resurrection. Well, you read through Fox's Book of Martyrs and you'll find that our Christian faith was bought with a great, great price. Of those who've gone before us who were tortured and murdered for the cause of Christ. But we see a great picture in the New Testament. Herod is a puppet of the Roman Empire. And he wants to please Rome, but he's been stuck as the king over the Jews. And the Jews and the Romans were always in trouble, and so he knew his chance for advancement in the Roman Empire is nil. But he recognized that the Romans and the Jews hated the Christians. And so in Acts chapter 12, Herod had James imprisoned and put to death. James was the pastor of the Baptist church there in Jerusalem. It was a Baptist church, by the way. Yeah, you can tell that because they followed Baptist polity and Baptist doctrine, which came straight from the Bible. And so Herod had James put to death, and the Bible says when he saw it pleased the Jews, he decided to take Peter also, and intending in a couple of days to kill Peter. And so Peter's put in jail. He's chained to four soldiers. Meanwhile, back at the house of where Mark lived, his mother had invited the church people to come and to pray for Peter's release. And it's the middle of the night. The next morning, he's going to be executed. I don't know how you react to stressful situations, but if they were going to kill me in the morning, I probably wouldn't be sleeping at night. But the Bible tells us here he is chained to four soldiers. Understand, he's put in jail for preaching. He's put in jail for Christianity. He's chained to four preachers, and he's sound asleep. And an angel appears and pokes him and says, "Get up." Peter thought he was dreaming. And the rule of a dream is you always do what angels tell you to do in a dream. Amen. So he got up. And when he got up, his chains fell off. And they said, "Get your shoes on. We got to get out of here." So Peter put his shoes on. He wrapped his garment about him. And the doors of the prison, whoop, opened up while all the guards are asleep. And they walked through the inner prison. And whoop, the doors open again. And he's outside. And he's thinking, "This is the coolest dream I ever had." And all of a sudden, the angel's gone. And Peter goes, "That's weird." He goes, "Usually in a dream you don't get cold, but I'm a little chilly." And he goes, "Wait a minute. This is real. This is real." And so he goes to the house of John Mark's mother, and inside they're all praying. "Can't you see these people?" Now remember, their pastor's just been put to death within the last few days. And now Peter is going to be executed in the morning. They didn't sign up for following Jesus to have their leadership and eventually them put to death. And so they're all in there praying with great passion and bitterness. "Oh God, please deliver Peter. God, please save him. Please don't let him die." Peter pounding on the door. Young lady named Rhoda comes and looks out the door, and she sees him, and she gets all excited. She goes, "He's here, he's here." She runs in, she goes, hey, "Quit praying, it's Peter." They go, "Shh, we're trying to pray in here. You don't need to pray. Peter's out there." "He's not out there, he's in prison." "Yeah, but we prayed for him to get loose, and now he's out." And so they get, "Would you stop? It can't be Peter. That's just his ghost." Think about that. They couldn't believe that God worked a miracle, but they did believe in ghosts. You know, what we preach and what we practice are sometimes so far away. It's so easy to talk about being a good Christian and so hard sometimes to live like a good Christian. And she said, "It's him. He's real. Come and look." And they came, and when they saw him, the Bible says they were all astonished. Yeah, astonished. "Wow, we prayed. We didn't think God would answer our prayer. We asked the Lord to save him, but we didn't think it really happened." Peter came in. They had a great celebration. He told them what happened. And you know what he did the next day? He went out and preached some more. Yeah. lots of lessons on faith in this particular little story. Number one, people who got their prayers answered weren't always convinced that the answer was going to happen. Sometimes we get worried and say, you know, I'm asking God to do this, I'm asking God to provide this, I'm asking God to help with this, but I don't know if I have enough faith. The answer to your prayer is not dependent on your faith, it's dependent on your God.
Amen.
And the very fact that you're answering is demonstrating faith. Let me ask you a question, answer out loud. Did the people pray for Peter to be delivered? Did God deliver Peter? Did God answer their prayer? Did they expect it? No. No. The fact that they wavered in their faith, the fact that they were pretty much convinced that what they were praying for was a waste of time, didn't have any effect at all on God. It was the mustard seed of faith that caused them to pray in the first place. It wasn't the great demonstration of faith. It was the fact that by faith, they prayed. And by faith, Peter, who was released from prison, got the idea that God will take care of me. And so he preached again the next day. By faith. Verse number 36. And others had trial of cruel mockings, and scourging, yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. Read the life of Jeremiah. Jeremiah is the last voice to a nation that has turned from God. He's calling out to them, repent or else, turn to God or else. And they all said, The man is crazy. And then the Babylonians come in and they take the city of Jerusalem captive. And they say to Jeremiah, this is your fault. You told us this was going to happen. You must be the cause of this. And they put him into prison. They threw him into a pit. At another time. After a while, they let him out of prison. You know what he did? He said, get right with God. You need to repent. They said, we don't like this. Back in the pit. They'd pull him out, he'd preach. They'd beat him, he'd preach. They'd imprison him, he'd preach. Here's a guy that by faith did what God told him to do, regardless of the consequences. Oftentimes in our Christian life, we're willing to please God if it makes sense to us. We're willing to obey God if what God has told us to do fits with our narrative. If we can see that this makes sense, sure, we'll do it. But what if God asks us to do something that just makes no sense? The Lord has already condemned Judah. The Lord has already sent in the Babylonians. Jeremiah, why don't you just sit back? Why don't you take it easy? You're not going to do a bit of good. Jeremiah said, I tried that. But my heart was like a fire. The word of God was like a hammer. And I could not stay. And so he preached again by faith. I hope that this study of Hebrews 11, if nothing else, we get the idea that faith isn't just in a little box. It's used different ways and under different circumstances. And some people had great faith in God and some people had little or no faith in God. But the same God did the miraculous. Verse 38, they were stoned, sawn asunder, tempted, were slain with a sword, They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts, mountains, dens, and caves of the earth. Ahab was a wicked man. He married Jezebel, who was even more wicked. Jezebel said, "We don't need this worship of the Lord God. We have a better God, Baal." And so they instituted Baal worship as the religion, as the state religion, as the national religion of Israel. In fact, anybody who didn't worship God was put to death. Obadiah took 50 of the prophets, and to protect them from this purge where they were trying to destroy all the preachers, hid them in a cave. Elijah comes and he says to Obadiah, he says, "Where's Ahab?" And Obadiah says, "Oh, you don't want anything to do with Ahab. He wants to kill me. He wants to kill these guys. He wants to kill you." And Elijah said, "Well, I need to find Ahab." And Obadiah said, "Well, I can tell you where he is, but he's not going to be happy to see you." And Elijah said, "I have a message from God. I've got to tell him anyway." And so Obadiah told him where he could find Ahab, and Obadiah went back to caring for the 50 men in the cave. And you know the story. Ahab confronts Elijah, and they end up on Mount Carmel, and all the prophets of Baal end up dead. And eventually God overthrows the religion of Baal. Here are 51 preachers who were afraid to take a stand for God. 51 preachers who would rather hide than do what they were supposed to do. And we look at these guys and say, what a bunch of cowards. What a bunch of rascals. What a bunch of terrible people. Wait a minute. Remember on Mount Carmel? The whole crowd gathers together. And Elijah says, "How long halt you between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, follow him." And the people answered not a word. That entire crowd, they were all afraid to admit that they served God. There were 51 preachers hiding, but they knew who they served. There were 51 preachers who didn't have the courage to take a stand, but they didn't betray their convictions either. 51 of these guys who could have been a better example, who could have done right, but at least they didn't do wrong. Why would God include these kind of people in the scriptures? Because sometimes, I wish every moment of every day I was super Christian. I wish that I was the best Christian I could possibly be 24 hours a day all my life. But there are sometimes I'm not. And in those times when we're not doing the best we could do, it's still important that we not do wrong. It's still important that we carry on. It's still important that we be faithful. We don't know what happened to these 51 preachers, but I have an idea. When under the ministry of Elisha, God began to send revival, I think they probably came out of hiding. And I think they probably got busy for God. You say, "Well, what makes you think so?" Well, I know that when the threat is yield to Baal or die, they didn't yield to Baal. They didn't stand up. They didn't say, "Go ahead and kill us." But they didn't yield either. By faith, they did what was right. And so my encouragement tonight is let's allow these folks to be an example to us. Let's allow them to when your faith isn't as strong as it ought to be, trust God. When you're not sure what's going to happen, trust God. Or like those in the house of Mark's mother, when you're pretty sure the roof's caving in and there's nothing you can do about it, trust God. Just trust God. Because even though we don't know what's going on, He certainly does.